On the day list this morning, Nigerians encourage corruption, cites Jim Festus, Francis Bacon, and mention Nigerian Gardner Forum calls for Obasanjo's resignation. Page 2 of the Punch newspaper. The Dailies, every day on Core TV News.
Let's quickly go straight into the dailies now. We'll begin with The Guardian. The Guardian is leading with the major headline story here. Gains pitfalls of Nigeria's currency swap deal with China. And the rider, divided stakeholders say policy may ease business, stifle local firms. And government must find Chibok girls, Ezekwesili insists. That's to the right-hand Canada. PDP zones chair to north, secretary to south. And another minor headline story, why fuel scarcity lingers by major oil marketers. Two riders, Port Harcourt refinery releases 28 million liters of PMS. World oil producers meet in deadlocked, crashes crude price. And look at the picture story here, very instructive. Roadside petrol sellers at Badagry Expressway, Lagos. Gentlemen, NNPC is raising our hopes again that Port Harcourt refinery has released 28 million liters of PMS. Enofe, I think that's cheery news.
I hope and wish it's true and factual. Because if indeed the refineries are afloat, we're tired of the aches and pains of this fuel scarcity. It's been lingering for since forever. And I think it's about time.
If it is true.
Yeah, if it is true indeed. Dick, well, let's quickly look at the gains pitfalls of Nigeria's currency swap deal with China. Is that really healthy when we hear that, yes, it might ease business, but it's going to stifle local firms? Is that what we need now?
It depends on how they deploy the gains of the visit. That will determine whether there will be gains or not. But what major stakeholders are fascinated about is the issue of that is going to ease the pressure on dollars. Because interestingly, for a very long time now, many of our international businessmen have been going towards the direction of China, because I'm in the freight forwarding industry. I know that many of our guys now patronize more of China than the Western products.
So they need more yuan.
So if we have that test swap, that means that they will not need to be converting their naira into dollar before they now go and get yuan. It's going to be direct yuan. And I was reading a report last night that gave the examples of some of the countries that even so we believe are not third world countries, like Switzerland, like China, like Canada, that are already into this kind of swap with China. And then I think they are not complaining. But like the chairman of the national president of the road to shore operators in Nigeria said, one Malam Kwadabi yesterday, that to know the effects this thing is going to have is that even among themselves, there's a consternation. Consternation in the sense that the patronage in terms of dollars definitely will have to drop. And he gave an example that between Thursday and Saturday, the dollar again has dropped by 20 naira, which means that the dollar to naira now is about 300 instead of 350 and stuff like that. But like we said, you know, at times when some of these newspaper reports, you don't have to believe them. Not that we don't have confidence in them. Let me just digress a bit. Just last night, the senior special advisor to the assistant to the president on media came out with a very comprehensive report that the issue of loan was never on the table when the president was traveling. And there was never a time they discussed the issue of loan. That people are now talking about $2.1 billion loan, $6 billion loan. What the president actually agreed with those people are investments. It could be to the tune whatever they're talking about. But my grasp with respect to the spokes of the president was, for the past 2 weeks, this thing has been flying in the air.
Yeah. That federal government, why did you debunk did it? Yeah, why did you keep quiet?
Why did they wait until when somebody of a governor even had to ignorantly write a letter to China that they should not grant a loan when there was no issue of loan? And I think that is why, at times, some of the reports we get in the newspapers or the news these days, media these days, we need to take them with a pinch of salt.
It's a shame. Okay.
If I'm allowed to, but
all right.
I think government is also responsible for many of these controversies, because I do remember a prominent member of this present government at the federal level came on air also to say that government was going to borrow at a single digit of 3% for China. I mean, that wasn't being, that wasn't from outside of government. I'm talking about another spokesperson of government saying they were going to borrow a 3% single digit 3% facility from China.
Yeah, but he didn't give. If at all, he said again, he didn't give a time frame. We are going to borrow the one we are borrowing now.
No, but, if the president is in China, and the spokesperson for government says, look, we are going to borrow, and whatever we are going to borrow is at the single digit of 3%. My first take is to believe that government is speaking to me.
No,
and then if 2-3 days later another person, because I've always had this problem of government saying this today and saying another tomorrow. And with all of these inconsistencies, it's difficult to even tell what the media should report. Because if the media reports this, 2-3 days later, the media is going to report something absolutely contrary to what has been reported. And so rather than hold the media liable, I think the blame should go to the source of the information. And in all instances, it comes from government.
Okay, gentlemen, let's leave that aside and just take what we have on the headlines, you know. Let's quickly move on to Vanguard, and Vanguard is trending with a minor piece here, how my wife died at Luth, bereaved husband Udebu. But the major headline story, 26 budgets logjam, presidency uncovers more infractions. Look at the infractions there, if the camera can just tilt up a little so that you see the distortions in front of can it go up a little more? Okay, well, all right, there it is, the distortions, the project, the, you know, and what was removed and the rest. I think here the south is hard hit here, but look at the riders. Saraki begs southern senators on Calabar Lagos rail project. Presidency open talks with NAS leadership. Railway workers south APC react. To the left hand corner of Vanguard, you have some minor headline stories here. Oshinbajo tax shell on Forcados terminal repair, and Fulani herdsmen sack Benue community. Now you're not hearing the director general of the Directorate of State Services commenting on this to tell us how many people have been killed in that Benue community. But you touch one Fulani man, then the Director General of the Secret Service will come out to say XYZ. Is that fair? Is that equitable?
Well, it's a general belief that because you are taking your comment from what he said about Biafra guys.
Absolutely.
It was a very uncharitable statement.
Very uncharitable.
Because the reason why we said that is why did that one become so important
that the Agatu killings of more than 500 people does not attract any comments from him? Is this country made for two different sets of people?
It's a very uncharitable comment, and then I was expecting to have other statements in there, but he has not. The issue of killings and stuff like that, I think some of us, because initially we had that fear that perhaps this thing goes beyond the Fulani herdsmen. And this one was reinforced sometime last week when the Minister for Internal Affairs came out to say they have the feelings that it's like Boko Haram having been incapacitated in the battlefront and now using some other tactics, using another decoy to enter the psyche of Nigerians. Because at times when you look at the activities of some of these Fulani herdsmen, you will ask yourself, are they going on a nomadic something, or they are out to wage a war against Nigerians? And I think if you look at it from that perspective, if the government already has an inkling, I think what the DSS should be doing more is to go into the root of this issue raised by Minister of Information and Internal Affairs and look at the possibility and the plausibility of the Boko Haram guys
infiltrating
these nomadic Fulani men to perpetrate evil within the society. I think that should be the concern of DSS now.
Hey, Dama?
Well, like I said, the last time I was here, when people die in this country these days, it's as if nothing happens. We just shrug it off and life goes on. And so when you read out the headline, attack on another Benue community, I almost was going to scream again because it's become so frequent, so often, that it's becoming like a daily expectation, you know, and that government is not taking any serious measures to curtail this is even more worrisome. And if well, let's just wait. Let's just wait, because there are so many dangerous signals around the place in this country.
All right, let us look at the budget log jam again. Presidency say they've uncovered more infractions. And look at the South seems to be really hard hit here, you know, man. Your people are feeling they're feeling the brunt here. Yeah. At one stage, we thought it was only the Lagos-Calabar rail project. But look at the other, even the Southwest, Lagos-Ibadan Express road. But I thought that one is being fanned out to private public partnership, this thing. Do you really need a budget for that? Look at the second Niger Bridge. Oh, even the East, too, is affected. So it's not limited. Odukmani to Ikorekpene roads. That one has been long, long dead for more than 3 decades. I can say Benin Sagamu Road. Oh, just forget it. You know, we had the minister who wept. She wept at the plight and says, is this what Nigerians go through? But at the end of the day, nothing was done. Then look at Itakpe Wari signaling. Can you imagine? That's a real this thing. Well, from Itakpe. Well, but
Christian, you see, we like in deluding ourselves so much in this country. When the issue of the budget padding, budget disappearance, and stuff happened, I had an audience with a former senator. The man was very mad at journalists. He saw he said because our ignorance we peddled and sell to Nigerians. The man was amazed that Nigerian journalists were making it look as if the issue of budget padding and what you have just seen, our budget swapping,
was
is new in Nigeria. The man said consistently that is what they have been doing since 1999. Okay, the issue of we passed the budget, we sent the highlights to the president, and there is a ceremonial signing of the budget. At the end of the year, the budget will not be implemented to the tune of even 50%.
30%.
It is because of the debt booby traps
that are in the place. Details, yeah.
Which by the time the thing details get to the presidency, it would have been too late because he would have appended his signature to it. And they knew their business. They knew the trade they applied. Normally, they send the highlights, the president signs, the details come later, you discover that you cannot implement the budget. But unfortunately for them, this time around, we have a Senate that is divided among itself and against itself. They were the one that gave the president a hint that president you are going to say something to you, don't sign until you get the details. But if Nigeria believe that this is whatever anomalies you have to cover in this budget, it is not new. That is what we have been doing since 1999. Perhaps the rift between the presidency and the Senate is going to chart a new course for our democracy. Maybe we'll begin to see democracy in action as from this year.
It will be great, yes, if indeed we can see democracy in action, you know, because Nigerians...
Because how can you explain? We have a Nigeria Comsat, that the federal executive budgeted 5 billion naira for it. And the National Assembly members, out of that 5 billion, removed 3.9 and put it under training and retraining. Does that make any sense to you?
To train
how can you have a budget of agriculture where the presidency had budgeted some amount of money for capital? And your friends in the National Assembly remove large chunk of that money and put it on buying Keke Maruwa. You begin to ask yourself, what
Keke Maruwa and Bohol, yes.
About billions of naira in buying Keke Maruwa.
Not that the Keke Maruwa are manufactured here, so you're patronizing local industries. You're taking that money to India.
Building it on town hall. They are saying they are developing rural area. Does that strike any chord in you? No, we need to...
They call it a consensus project.
I just don't want to be angry this morning.
No, it's the first thing. On a Monday.
Yeah, it's a Monday morning. I got loads of work to do this morning. Okay, let's look at the punch, and the punch is trending with, as usual, just above the masthead, panic as schoolboys go missing in Lagos community. These are toddlers. 5 banks record 54 billion naira drop in profits. Good news. The punch. Poor power supply may linger till May. Federal government plans special force to tackle pipeline vandalism. And the major headline story here, NLC orders attack Senate over move to amend CCT Act. distribution of exotic vehicles divides senators. And to the right-hand corner, some minor headline stories there. Troops uncover Boko Haram underground armory. Benue farmers sue Fulani herdsmen for 100 billion naira. Kashamun can't speak for Southwest PDP, but they George. And a very devastating earthquake picture story here. Ecuador earthquake kills 238, injures 1,500. Beg your pardon. That's really horrible. Look at it. The banks are having drops in profit now. Five banks dropping 54 billion naira. It shows that they've not been working, isn't it? They've not really been doing their banking. They've not been borrowing to the real sectors and the rest to be able to plough back some small profits here and there.
Again, that takes you back to this currency swap thing. Because we see, when you say the banks have not been lending to the receptor, I challenge people to ask, where's our receptor? You know, because if you food and beverages laid off between January and the present, they have laid off 7,200.
Oh my.
Nobody's talking.
Oh my.
Because their production has gone down.
Because people are not taking, somebody who has not eaten about what's his business with beverage.
So, you take a plunge into the textile industry.
Mm.
It's also on its way down. And then you take a trip, in every sector of our economy is going downward. And of old, these banks used to survive on government deposits, government lodgements. And now that those monies are no longer coming, they are laying off workers, they are going downhill too.
And they are increasing our own administrative charges and the rest.
They are trying to squeeze every money they can squeeze out of our pocket.
I know there are some campaigners who want to sue them because I want to, you know, be joined in that suit. Every now and again, I just see deductions. 10 naira, 100 naira, 150, 20 naira in any little transaction.
Yeah, charge for SMSs you didn't get. You know, so and that's part of the reality of the fact that we never really had the healthy economy. Well, we have always had the pretentious environment where people, you know, give the impression that this much is going on. And now that we are going into all of this, because again, have we actually thought about the consequences of going head on into this alliance with China? Because what's going to happen is that our small businesses are virtually going to disappear.
That would be dangerous.
But it's a reality that
because it's the driver of any economy.
Yeah, because the thing is, before now, our president complained about the importation of toothpick, handkerchiefs, and
is that the kind of business deals that we're going to be signing?
But they are coming from China. And then if you are going to have access to yuan straight up, and you don't have to buy dollar and all of those processes, and then people, everybody is jumping on the next airplane to get into China to buy whatever he can buy and bring back into this country, that's what you're going to have. And gradually, your smaller industries are going to shrink and eventually go comatose. They are already comatose, and many of them are managing to crawl. And so, you're just going to have an overflooding of our environment with all manners of things from China.
All right. Okay, let's quickly take our last paper. Time is really gone against us now. The Nation has above its masthead some minor front page stories there. Dasuki Gate, PDP secretary begs to refund 75 million naira. That's a wise decision. Opera over Senate's move to amend CCB law. APC lawyer slam Fayose over letter to China. And pipeline security forced to end vandalism coming. 368 strange projects in ministry's 2016 budget. And some other minor stories below the masthead of the Nation. Job scammers on the prowl and police await complaints. 51 foreign investors exit equities and bond markets. It's not too good. Inside, OPEC fails to agree on production cut. Gunmen kidnap NNPC chief, maybe for petrol. US agrees to give Nigeria $480 million Abacha family loot. That is humongous. Let me use the language of one of our guests here. $400 million. This government, look, there's money after all. Okay, look at some of the riders here. AGF, EFCC chair seal deal with Justice Department. Anti-graft agency seeks records of recovered £22.5 million. Why did this man steal all this money? He practically relocated the CBN into his Aso Villa. What kind of criminality is this? The money is never ending. Wow. Look at it. Abacha accounts and investment portfolios. I think this is good for a read. Doraville Properties Corporation, $287 million. HSBC Fund Administration in Jersey, $12 million. Rayville International SA, $1 million. Standard Alliance Financial Services Limited, $144 million. Mecostar Securities, I tell you, gentlemen, I'm going to...
It's annoying.
You just want to run sick here when you have, you know... And look at the picture story. This is great. Boko Haram troops seized largest single cache of arms. The hole, look at the picture story there. The hole inside which the arms and ammunition were hidden. EFCC to probe Ondopoli. Drone hits British Airways plane at Heathrow. Wow, that's strange. EFCC, it's like selective probe. That's what they're doing. You remember the Yaba College of Technology, the bossa, who squealed about the monumental frauds running into several hundreds of millions there. He was rather dismissed, and EFCC is not proving it. And so, if people now raise the allegation that EFCC has been compromised, would they be talking from the blues, Digbo?
No, the issue of probe, because it has stages, because it gets to a stage where it becomes public property. In the sense that there are some underground investigation they will be doing.
For 1 year now, Dipo.
No, it depends.
It's over 1 year.
No, it depends.
The man has brought out documents to show that look at the frauds. I'm the bosser. What could be more than this?
Well, it's not as easy as you think, because when they swing it to action, they will say FEC is arresting before going with the investigation. But let's give it the time, because as a matter of fact, I pity the FEC troops, because there is so much work on the table of this guy. What you should be looking about is FEC the only organization that is set up to fight
for ICPC it. Does not make noise.
We have a police. We have a police force. Nigerian police force should be doing it. We have SFU. So that is why
the special fraud unit.
We have so many
of the Nigerian police.
We have so many agencies. SFU is being headed by a commissioner of police, somebody with sterling quality. So I think the some of these things should be let off by the FCC and let us divert some of these things to other agencies. Because if anything happens now, even if a woman is holding her husband, you drag the woman to hear.
Of course now.
It's becoming too much. Let the other agencies be made to work, especially the police.
No, but again, sorry to put it, you know, we have created, we have the administrators of this country deliberately weakened the police.
Oh yeah, capacity. The military, Babangida especially.
Yes, and then if we are expecting the police to do miracle or to do, because you see the kind of resources at the disposal of the EFCC is the reason why everybody goes to the EFCC.
Oh yeah.
And we have seen the EFCC.
You want to go to the police station and they tell you bring money for fuel. It's even worse at this time.
Because, as a matter of fact,
they don't have it.
They don't
have lights in the police station. They don't have the incident paper that you're supposed to write. So you have to go and buy.
No, it's not that they don't have it. See, some people at the top have eaten the money.
No, but I.
The thing does not trickle down to those. So these things are projected for at the beginning of every year.
And everybody.
But you go and meet a DPO. By the time the thing gets. When the money is released from the Police Service Commission. By the time you get to IGP, somebody edits it. It comes down to who the next person in rank. Somebody edits it.
No, you have the the Minister of Police.
Somebody has the responsibility.
Is gone. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. No, well, somebody has the responsibility of supervision. I don't want to whether the Minister of Police Affairs is gone or is not gone. You know, because the functions of the Nigerian Police Force comes under the office of the Minister for Internal Affairs, whether he wants to run away or not. And be that as it may, it is absolutely impossible. Nobody can excuse what has happened to the Nigerian Police Force today. Because over the years, we have seen, I can say on good authority, that the average policeman on the street is patrol van, he feces, he fuels it, he buys the tire.
That's if they have patrol vans. And don't you and see them at the bus stops where looking for, how do they call them, staff?
And the patrol vans are rickety.
Chris, I disagree. They do have Almost all the state governors at the beginning of every year give them vehicles.
How many?
What do they do with these vehicles? They can't use get vehicles. What kind of vehicles with their girlfriends?
No, that's
go
not
and see them.
No, that's not true, sir.
These people.
That's not true, sir. Because the thing is, you give a man vehicles. What are the provisions for the maintenance of these vehicles?
They don't maintain them, Dickbo. They don't.
The same governors that give the vehicles.
They don't.
What are the number one necessity for running a vehicle is fueling. Who fuels the vehicle?
I am very much.
There are no fuel vouchers.
I am very much aware of Lagos State. Lagos State government, even right from the Fashola era, no, they fuel these vehicles they give to
them. Sorry,
I am telling you, go and meet these boys from the road.
Do they maintain the vehicles?
Sorry,
Lagos State government.
Sorry, sir.
What I'm saying, these guys are not using these vehicles.
So,
I don't agree.
Sorry, sir. You may be mistaking the Rapid Response Squad for the Nigerian Police generally. Because the RRS are under a special arrangement. For the average police station that you go to, the patrol vans are fueled by the policemen on duty.
No, apart from the RRS.
But you see what? You know what? While I was growing up, what the police did to get fuel, even in the civil service, was at the end of each month, there were vouchers booklet allocated to each department.
That's not it, Eoma. When I was growing up, my father is a retired police officer, and let me say here, the man that arrested Oyenusi, Mighty Joe, and the rest, my father, when they formed then the special anti-robbery squad, then, you know, the police had their fuel depots and where they go to get fuel from. So you never saw any police van going to, any filling station and the rest. What happened to those things? Those are the questions we should be asking. You get the point? You know, it's just the usual degeneracy. The decay in all facets of our lives, of our national lives. There's really not. What do you want to write home about the Nigerian society?
And so government took over the ESCC and celebrated so much. And, you know, it's no other person can be better, you know, quoted than the former president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria and the person of Chief Olusegun Obasanjo, who says by himself, maybe by the information at his disposal and by experiences, BSC is a two-legged good dog. and he must have his reasons.
All right, let's look. I don't think we aren't going to take a break now. Let's go straight on to our main topic. We've ended the segment for the dailies. And if you're just joining us, you're on to our breakfast participatory program, Court Digest and Court TV. And our topic again today, it's right there, the CCT-CCB amendment, the NAS fraud conspiracy. Gentlemen, what is going on? The number three citizen is being tried, by this body. And the next thing we're seeing is the National Assembly coming up with an amendment. Is that auspicious? A plausible move, to kill the CCB, CCT?
But I'll start by saying, any living man would do anything possible to protect his social status. What the National Assembly is doing, actually, is self-preservation. And whether to the detriment of Nigeria, it is none of their business. As far as they are concerned, they want to keep their social relevance and their social status. And how they do it, they don't seem to care about whatever anybody's hue or cry is. And that's where we have found ourselves. And if the senior president needs to go down for whatever, so long as his case can be proved in court, I think because whatever it is, whatever the National Assembly is doing or ends up doing, should not have any retroactive effect. And so whatever the amendments now, maybe they are presenting themselves in the future, but I don't see Saraki getting out of the hook.
Dupo, what do you think about this? Because some people are saying that this amendment is going to be retroactive.
No, it's not. It is not possible in terms of the CCT, CCB. Let me say CCB, CCT.
It's a law. They are amending the law. So why is it impossible?
Because already the case has commenced.
Yeah.
And such laws don't have a retroactive effect. But I think my worry, Christian, and which Nigerians don't seem to understand, is that this CCB, CCT amendment is a decoy. Nigerians, maybe out of negligence of not sourcing around for information or under reported by the press, Nigerians don't know that these guys are also going to amend the Administration of Criminal Justice Act. They are going to comment that one this week, according to the other paper. And what that one means is that all the gains of the ACJ of 2015
will be eroded.
Because they are very much aware, and based on what they want to achieve with that amendment, is that all these frivolous injunctions
will come back again.
Sort,
yeah.
Which they have normally pursued to the Supreme Court level, that allowed the case of an ex-governor that left office in 2007 to be in court when the reason
for nine years.
That is exactly what they are driving at. And when that one comes into effect, it becomes operational. That means Saraki can as well go to court
and take a perpetual injunction.
Yes, that is why I am worried that Nigerians are not just looking at the core of National Assembly. They are not looking at this ACJA, which they want to start this week. Christian, what these guys are doing is nothing but what they call legislative rascality. There's nowhere in the world where a law is made to protect either an individual or a group of people. Laws generally are made to protect the generality of Nigerians. Now, what are the prayers? What are the things they are looking at? Some people are saying, yes, it is, you know, it is a good step, but it is, the timing is not right. The timing can never be right.
Never.
If you look at the problems of Nigeria, if you look at the CCB, because it's a constitutional matter, what they are doing is what they call exercise in futility.
Mm.
Because if they even amend the CCT or CB Act, TCB Act takes its root from the
national constitution. From the constitution. So are you going to amend the constitution?
I know the process of amending the constitution.
Yeah.
It has to go round.
Round the
And two-thirds of the states must concur.
Absolutely.
So at times when we look at the caliber of people in the National Assembly, you ask yourself, why are we so blessed? There's a noble in that way. Why is Nigeria so blessed with them? What they are doing cannot lead them to anywhere if only they know their right from their left. Because if you go, they said they want to protect officers or government officials that have become the victim of what they call persecution. Go and read that.
Persecution of what?
Even granted that, go and look at Section 153, Section 157 of the Constitution that set up the CCB. It's a constitutional matter. You cannot be a member of CCB except you are the president is going to appoint. I get my point.
Yeah.
But based on the advice of the Nigeria Judicial Council, and even when the government is going to appoint, he has to send it to the Senate for approval. So this idea of CCB is under secretary to the government of Federation, I don't know where that one came from. They cannot tell us that because we are no more illiterate in this country. Are you getting my point? The CCB is protected by the Constitution of Nigeria.
Absolutely.
And even the Constitution says the President cannot remove any member of the CCB except there is a two-thirds concurrence in the National Assembly. Especially the Senate in particular.
Mm.
So what is this noise about? Oh, we want to protect the government official. But let me tell you one thing. Maybe as the program of progresses, we now look at where did they start from. Don't forget that when this case started, they quickly got somebody who wrote a petition against the chairman of CCT.
Yeah.
They organized a public sitting that the guy should come and defend himself. Maybe the guy who wrote the petition realized what he was going into. He did not show up because there was no any substance in that petition.
In the petition.
What they were looking at was to find a way of getting the lad
removed.
When that one failed, they now came up with this CCT amendment. It's going nowhere. And I think Nigerians are going to
spread. But look at it. You would have thought that it would be the opposition that is supposed to be crying blue murder here about, you know, the inherent fraud in this amendment. But the opposition is in tandem with the ruling APC party. And the ruling APC party, I mean, with the majority, does not seem to be liaising with its national secretariat at all.
No, but the distortion in the political landscape is frightening. That's because before I got on set, I did mention that under normal circumstances of Nigeria of old, we would have had at least two coups by now. The arrogance of those who run the affairs of this country today is derivative of the fact that first, fundamentally, they think Nigeria is where Nigeria was in 1952. And that Nigerians have not learned anything, and Nigerians do not have the capacity to learn anything. And so when they sit down in their private, because I just ask myself, where is this intended to take us to? Because if all of this struggle is to preserve a Saraki in office, the emergence of Saraki as a senior president, but it's because in all of this fight, if the APC continues to fight itself and then they continue to drag Nigeria into this fight. The eventual victim of all of this fight is the Federal Republic of Nigeria. It's the ordinary Nigerian who, at the end of the day, is, because for me, the question we have always asked as region is, where is the policy choice for this administration? But with the confusion that is playing out right, left, and center, it's almost impossible for even a reasonable person to sit down in the helm of affairs and function as the president of this country. It's absolutely impossible. The distractions are numerous.
That's fantastic. But Christian, maybe there's need for us to understand, especially we Nigerians, if we take a look at what has been happening since 1999. The Nigerian National Assembly is like a cult group, where the moment they get in there, they, to some extent, they throw away their political party guard. And I'll give you an example. When they first came in 1999, the very first thing they fought for was what they call furniture allowance.
I remember 7 million naira then in 1999.
For matter of national, for Senate, then 5 for House of Representatives. Yeah. That one had nothing to do with political parties.
At all.
Again, on the issue of their allowances and their salaries, since 1999,
no Nigerian
knows how much. Even if you ask, when the PDP was in charge, if you ask the APC, what are ACN or whatever, the guy will say, I don't know. I only receive a lot.
I get a lot.
That is the way they have constituted National Assembly. It's a cult group. The moment they get into that place, they forget about their political parties. Maybe Nigerians have forgotten. Up until last year, since 1999, PDP has always been having at least 70% of National Assembly.
Yeah.
And they have always been the one that have been giving the executive problems. Yeah. That is why we came up with the fact that PDP was the opposition of PDP. Because they were always the one in charge. When Galina Abba was the House of Representatives speaker, they were the one who wanted to impeach Obasanjo.
Yes.
Obasanjo was a member of PDP.
Mm.
Under Okadigbo, when all of them were under PDP, the guy who moved the motion, though he came from ANPP, Senator Atonziribe, was a PDP person.
Oh, yeah.
So it has always been like that. When they get into a National Assembly, they forget about their party. What matters most is how, like he said, self-preservation. Because the problem they have with CCT, this problem has always been there since 1999. They all don't declare every property that they have. So their fear is now is that if they allow Saraki to fall, the executive will go after the others. So that is why they are doing, like this one of CCBCCT cannot catch Kalashiraki because his case has taken off.
Mm.
But all of them know that this thing will begin to catch them one after the other. If it is a rumor, I wouldn't know. The guy who is the major sponsor of this thing, reports came out on Saturday that he himself purchased a property belonging to the Delta State government. And he did not declare it in his
in the Senate there.
So what they are doing, like my friend said, is to preserve themselves. Okay, this one is almost gone. So like it's almost down. How do we make sure that this thing, we are not kept in the web? And to make sure that they protect Saraki, that's why they are amending the ACJA. The ACJA, they want to amend so that you can bring up the
all kinds of injunctions.
You can bring up stay of action so that or proceeding so that while you pursue frivolous injunction in the higher court, the action at the CCT will not comment. The action at the high court will not comment. That is that will not go ahead. That is why we have some cases that started in 2007 after those guys left office. The cases are still in court.
How about former governor of River State, Odili? He's perpetual injunction. He's still subsisting?
Yes.
And the NJC and even the Chief Justice of Nigeria still allows that.
Nobody went to court to overturn it.
Nobody. So that is the problem.
The law, law in this country can never be for the poor masses.
It can never be.
It's not.
No. It's not intended to.
No, it's not.
That is why
somebody perpetually. That since 2007.
A perpetual injunction.
That's a federal high court, I believe, gave that ruling.
Yes. Sometimes in 2010 or 2011, there was a Minister of Justice who made an attempt, or seemingly an attempt, to challenge it. He got to say that the trial judge said, you these guys, you are wasting the time of the court. You are not pursuing this thing diligently. You will know that there wasn't any political will
to pursue that matter.
And this guy is walking the street. And that guy who stole a telephone,
he's in jail.
This 6 months, the guy is sentenced now. That is, if he's sentenced, or else he will... We were told of just like we were in this country when they said the Chief Judge of Lagos State went to Ikoyi prison and freed 16 people One of them has been standing trial for 16 years.
15.
If I saw, two of them. If you see this boy.
No, he's gone.
If you see this boy, you will weep for this.
No, he's gone. He can never be rehabilitated again.
But this guy has been awaiting trial.
Yeah.
You can go and ask maybe what this guy stole. Yeah. Maybe 5,000 naira.
Yeah.
And somebody will steal billions of naira. He will go to court in Welsh, Tash, Agbada. Some people will even come
with
and
with Tash and all of that. With drummers and.
And the National Assembly will be shut down.
Yes.
Oh yes.
No, but there is a palpable worry here about our legal system. If the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, the ACJA, is tampered with by the National Assembly, it's going to cause a lot of judicial or legal chaos, just like you've highlighted. But my worry here, we don't have any member of the Nigerian Bar Association who are the progenitors of this law, because they sat down and look at it. Why is the administration of justice slow in this country? And they came out with a perfect or a near perfect document, at least that has accelerated, that has made the EFCC, for example, to have some to get his part of his credibility back, to accelerate the dispensation of justice. Yeah. If you look at all the fraud allegations and the rest, they're almost nearing completion stage.
Yeah.
The EFCC has finished its own, made its own submissions and the rest.
Yeah.
They've closed their own case. So it's the defense.
Yeah.
This, we have never seen this before in Nigeria. Yeah. It's coming at a record time. So where would this leave us, really? The NBA is not coming out to say anything yet. In some climes, sorry, Dipo, gentlemen, in some climes, you even find the Chief Justice of that country coming to say something that what the National Assembly is about doing is like a coup against the Nigerian judiciary.
But the truth is, you are putting me in a very tight position.
Huh?
What we have here is, there's been this lifelong conspiracy against the people. You know, because if each time people get, like you said, it's just that the court extends beyond the National Assembly.
Mm.
Because those, when the governors sit down together too, under the governor's forum, whatever they do behind closed doors, at that level, partisan interest is not considered. Because if you look at the retirement packages for former governors across the country, across political parties, you'll be amazed.
Yes.
And yet, they don't quarrel with that.
Yeah.
And so if you are able to reverse the cost of the dispensation of justice in this country, and you slow it down even to the point of death, it is good for this individual, because what it means is that he can stay in court
for 20 years. Yes.
They can afford the legal practitioners, they can pay all the sons in the world, they can go there, because when they go to court, they go with a convoy of legal luminaries, and for them it is
the good. Other man came with 80 lawyers to do what?
No, but it is, and what do they do? Oftentimes, it's all frivolous injunctions, all manners of applications are filed, and the process is dragged forever. And somebody, while he's in court on the corruption charge, comes back 4 years later to contest for another office. He goes to office. I know of a governor who was accused of stealing. In his own case, they brought to court evidences of direct transfer from government account into his private account. The man did his years, completed his tenure, then the matter went to court. He went into the Senate. He has done 8 years in the Senate. Matter of fact, he's about to do 12 years in the Senate.
Which governor is this now?
Please, will you spare me?
No, but
let's not go into that
Christian.
You know, sometimes you just wonder why are some of us from this part of the world?
Christian, that is why some of us believe that whatever might be the inadequacies of the immediate past president, the scooter should be given to him for assenting to that.
Because the people who surrounded him.
Because if you know where we are looking, where we are coming from, especially after the expiration of the tenure of the first set of governors in Nigeria, that was in 2007.
Yeah, and then Rufai, you remember?
Nuhu Ribadu.
Yes, I was covering the National Assembly.
He went to the National Assembly and said they had investigated all the governors.
With 29, only one or so, yeah.
Was seen to be a little above
board. Yeah, above board.
everybody expected that there would be a flurry of activities.
No.
And there was. When they left office,
yeah,
there was a flurry of activities. They were arrested. Many of them were tied to court. And at the end of the day, some of the cases are still in court. So when some people now came together and said, no, we cannot continue like this.
And many of those people are in the Senate now.
Yes. Because many of those governors are in the Senate now. So because they realize that when you have a case that is in the court and you have witnesses, these witnesses also have other things they are pursuing.
Yeah.
It will get to a stage where they will forget the nitty-gritty of the matter.
Yeah.
So that by then they are invited as positional witness, there will not be cohesion. They will not be coherent. And that's exactly what they wanted. That's why they allow cases to drag. So some people now can figure out and say, no. That was how they came about the ACJ. What does it say? It says that, yes, if you have been taken to a court and you have any problem with any of the proceedings, nobody is stopping you from going to the higher court.
Mm.
But while you are pursuing your appeal in the higher court, your case must go on.
The substantive issue must continue.
And that was what Saraki wanted to hide under when the matter came in eventually.
Mm.
When he started running from pillar to post, from high court, trying to stop the proceeding. High court said, no, you can't do this.
Mm.
He went to appeal court.
Yeah.
Appeal court said, no, we can't do this. The matter got to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court was conscious of the ACJA, but there was palpable tension in the country then. Against what the ACJA said, Supreme Court said, okay, Mr. Rotimi William Jacobs, can you assure that this matter will stay at least for some time? Because there was tension all over the country. As if Saraki was the only person to go to CCT. He is not. We have cases of people that have gone to CCT since 2007. Actually, who went there? I think Atiku went there. Adamesia went there to CCT. Nigeria was not threatened with fire and brimstone, unlike what Saraki is doing now. So Supreme Court said, okay, Mr. Rotimi Jacobs, can you assure us that this case will... We are not stopping the case because Supreme Court said we don't have the power. But can you assure us that you guys will stay action as a city so that we can look at the merits or the demerits of Saraki case? What those guys were doing, because at Supreme Court level, they go beyond law.
Mm.
They look at what some people call the social aspect of law. There was tension. How can we doubt tension? Okay, CCT, we are not stopping you. But can you assure us that you will stay action? And Rotimi Jacobs said, okay, my lord, we will stay action. And the thing started from that November. They didn't read their judgment
until March.
March. By that time, tension had come down.
Mm.
He read their judgment. They said, Mr. Taraki,
go back
and face your trial. You know, the guy did not stop there. The guy wanted to start another case from the federal court, federal high court. That was when the case of the man who just gave the judgment last week, Kafarati, came up. It's an abuse of court processes. A matter you have taken to high Supreme Court, you are now starting again from the high court. But that is their stock in trade. They have been doing it. They will pursue a frivolous injunction. Or it may be ordinary, something that doesn't even make any sense. They will pursue it from high court. And while they are doing that, federal high court of appeal, there will be an appeal for stay of action. That means they cannot continue the case.
Mm.
The matter will get to Supreme Court. They will lose there. They will now come back again and raise another frivolous application. That is their talking trade. And like this time around, that one has failed. That is why they want to tinker with the ACJA. And Nigeria should open their eyes. The CCTCCB is a decoy. They are going to start the ACJA amendment this week. And that is one is the real issue that is going to start.
Have you heard anything that the Nigerian Bar Association is doing to this effect?
No, they have not. Well, you cannot blame them. Because they have to study. Because I discussed with a lawyer friend sometimes, I think Saturday night. He said that we can come to on air and begin to express our emotion and sentiments. But lawyers who want to study and look at the loopholes in the matter, as well as the merits and the demerits. So maybe they together they will come. But I've been listening to lawyers. Our friend was on Radio Continental, Okwe Bango.
Okay.
And Bani was there telling Nigerian that what these guys are doing is nothing. I am calling it legislative rascality. It's an abuse of the power.
It is
Section 4 is very, very clear.
Mm.
They have the power to make laws for the good governance of Nigeria.
Yeah.
Nobody is disputing that part. But there's also this general belief that you don't make a law or tamper with a law to favor an individual or to favor a group of people. Laws are usually made or tampered with for the generality of Nigerians.
Absolutely.
I wonder the type of people we have as leaders. About 2 weeks ago, when the issue of Panama Papers came up, I watched the British
Prime Minister.
When
you
were grilling their Prime Minister,
mm-hmm.
you will enjoy democracy.
Mm-hmm.
Nigerian National Assembly has not even deemed fit to have a sitting. Your president, the president of the Senate,
they will lock that senator out. They will be suspended.
The president of the Senate has been mentioned.
It's going to be suspended. Nobody, and you know what that means when he's suspended.
You watched the British Prime Minister when he was in the Parliament defending.
Didn't you see the demonstration against him that he should go?
My dear, it was. You will enjoy democracy. Maybe we'll get there one day, but not with this point that we have as lawmakers. No, not.
But look, I read out some of the provisions, you know, of the powers of the tribunal in imposing punishment.
Yes.
No jail term. With all the gargantuan fraud, you know, that some of these people may have committed, a lot of the stealing, it's just banning the person for 10 years, you know, from holding any political or public office. And for feature of such a property.
No, but you must also understand the spirit. When Babangida was eventually coming to give that to us as a law, he had his own ideas of what he wanted to do with it. That's the unfortunate thing about this country. No law actually is thought of or brought forth for the primary interest of the Nigerian people. Everybody that comes with a law has an ulterior motive for projecting the law and for pushing it forward. And each time they do that, because all of these things, the CCB thing that is ongoing, is because for some people, the latitude given by that law, by the Babangida administration, is too far, too wide. So they need to narrow it. They need to ensure that there are no criminal proceedings. You don't even listen to anything that's got. Maybe CCTV will just be, let people go to have tea and then have coffee, share biscuits, and then go back home. Because for those who occupy the political space, it's the landmark given to the CCTV and the CCTV is too broad. So they need to narrow it. And you know, if those who today say, look, we have had enough of this, because again, I am not too sure that people understood what the former president was doing when he assented to
ACJB.
I'm sure they were not too conscious what he was doing. If they were as conscious,
but it was passed by the National Assembly.
Yes. But you have to look again at the circumstances that informed the passage. You know, because the NBA was on their neck, you know, and at that point in time they also needed to play to the gallery. That they always had at the back of their mind that the way we get back there, we are going to kill it.
And let me just add to what Lafayette has just said. You know, I have a friend, at times he will be talking about Factor X, whatever we are doing.
Mm.
And I give you some instances. In the year 2005, when Obasanjo called the removal of Adolphus Abara from the National Assembly because he did not make available to him 1 billion naira to conduct what his own national political conference, which Jonathan also did. Obasanjo felt, because when the matter got to National Assembly, they said, no, we aren't going to release any money for you. Go and look at your security vote. Obasanjo felt hard. So when the issue of Osuji, the Economy Minister for Education, that in that bribe for budget scandal, he quickly mounted pressure on Sawadbara. He must go. And the guy had no choice because Obasanjo was exerting pressure on the National Assembly then. And he brought, and they brought in
this guy, Ayim.
No, not Ayim. Namani.
Namani.
He didn't know that he was blessed. God was working for Nigeria and Nigerians. Because if Adolphus was for Abara, but to be the speaker, the Senate president, when the issue of third term issue came up, it would have said true.
Mm-hmm.
That is the factor X that my friend is always talking about. So the same thing to what the NFA is saying, that when they were working on the ACJA, it was then an act then. They didn't know that it could come one day.
It was a bill then.
Mm. It was to haunt them. But now back to the issue of the question you asked, that why did they only, that no jail term for all the allegations?
Yeah.
You see, after listening to the first and second witnesses at the CCT trial, that question struck me. D'accord. Why did these people take Saraki to CCT on these allegations?
Yes.
Why did they take him to a conventional
court?
There are limits for him.
That was when I now went into the constitution. And maybe some of us, even I didn't know until I saw it,
that even after the trial assisted,
he can say go
and
to
he's,
the
court. He's not guilty.
Yeah.
That the government can still take him to a confessional.
Yes.
That one is still pending.
He's still pending.
So,
yeah.
Like my friend said yesterday, he said they should write a book or a novel where they call the many troubles of Saraki. The troubles are already there.
And they are piling.
They are already, they have even compiled. So maybe that was why he struggled. He fought to a nail to make sure that the CCT case did not start. Because that is their talking trait. They will make sure that they kill the trial, it doesn't start. Such that at the stage, it will be swept under the carpet. So the issue of the Commissioner Court to go and look at the criminal aspect of it is still pending. Because the Constitution is very clear. It is allowed. What they are only waiting for is only that the punishment of the CCT. I think maybe that what the, I am not reading the mind of the government. I'm only saying the punishment of CCT. Are you getting my point? The prerogative of mercy does not cover it. The moment CCT said this is their judgment, no president, no government official can order any people of mercy say we are pardoning Saraki. And you know the penalties. One, he's going to lose his office. Two, he's going to be banned from contesting for the next 10 years. And three, all the properties that are mentioned
will be seized,
will be confiscated with government. It's very curious. So everybody will want to fight now and then to make sure the case does not start. He had a very bad case. The allegations are very deep, with dates.
Okay, let's go on a short break, and I think it's time for us to ask our viewers to call us on our regular number, which is +234 for international callers, 816-481-8001. I'll take that again for the benefit of the unsighted, because it should soon be put on your screen there. The number to call us, +234 816 481 8001. You join us again after the break.
Is it what crazy or talk crazy or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy
news making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, genuine looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Fuck you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to dispute. I said, oh, hell
on Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
You can now watch Court TV News live from anywhere in the world on our website, www.courttvnews.com. Click on Live TV on our website and watch us live.
And welcome to Court TV Primetime Days.
To follow us on Twitter, click on Twitter icon on our website. And Facebook, click on the Facebook. And YouTube to see all our previous news production. You can also watch us live on YouTube. Click Court TV. Leave a space, then news. Court TV News, a 24-hour news station.
For topical issues, Nigerians must have something to say.
Arms, we don't need arms for anything. Let them put it into education.
They need to buy another arms now.
What are they fighting for?
What? Who?
Government should deal with them squarely.
Please, help us bring back our girls.
No money, no markets. We are dying. Everybody is crying. Nothing.
Any man God support, no man stops.
It's a prophecy I believe he must have received from heaven. Yes.
The people giving voice to the voiceless.
Every day, every hour, and every minute, news break in Nigeria. Things happen so fast, it's most times difficult to track and comprehend them. But that's what we do right here on Digi 360.
2015, would you want to come back again?
It's like asking Jesus Christ if he knew he was going to die, will you want to come back as the savior of the world again?
We do not just help you track the stories, we break them down, explore all the angles, analyze the issues so that you can fully comprehend the stories and use them to make the right decisions.
Is it what crazy or talk crazy or what type of crazy is that
except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, driving looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to disrepute. I said, oh, hell
on
me.
Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
All right, so welcome back. Let's quickly remind our viewers again that when you're calling in, please remember to turn down the audio of your TV set so that we don't have that infraction. Let me use that word, you know, for want of the technical word. I think I'm really overwhelmed with this topic, with this amendment, with this fraud. How can a group of people voted for be amending and act just to so that they can continually perpetuate fraud or fraudulent tendencies? Because, gentlemen, can you deduce anything from that?
Impunity. Because some of our colleagues that were the Senate on the very first day when this issue came up, that they listed it on the other paper, but they made two other papers, two sets, one for journalists
and one for themselves.
He said, unfortunately for them, the person who distributed the other papers gave journalists the one
for these
amendments. And because, don't let me say they have no shame, they withdrew that thing in the front of everybody and started giving them the one that they didn't contain. So that means they knew what they were doing was not proper.
Yeah.
If not, why did you clothe it in
CBC?
Why are you using the BCCT as a decoy when the real thing you are targeting is the ACJA, which they will start discussing as from this
month tomorrow?
If they are clean and they are doing it for the benefit of Nigeria, what stopped them from saying journalists, okay, take? Why are they pretending as if the CCB that they want to remove it usually, from under the SDF control?
Usually,
which has never been the case. It has never been.
Yeah.
The president will appoint members of CCB on the advice of the Senate, the CCT and the chairman.
Okay, what Dennis is calling us from Abak. I wonder why I'm not getting across to him. Good morning, Emmanuel. Hello, Emmanuel.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah.
How are your family?
Thank you for joining us, Emmanuel. Yeah. Quickly go on with what
you're calling from Kaduna.
You're calling from Kaduna, okay, Emmanuel from Kaduna, okay, that's great, yeah.
The issue of a CCTV, the way I see it is a very simple something that just would understand one thing. The 200 people that are sitting, the people that are sitting very close to you,
yeah,
I have to for them, I have to watch that send them every day, entirely on TV, CCTV, all these channels, we're happy with them. They're telling us everything about Saraki, this. It's not the issue of only Sarah, it's the issue of the people. What I want Nigeria to do to do is a very simple something. Well, your father had it.
Oh, what a shame. We lost him there. That's Emmanuel from Kaduna. You know, gentlemen, I am more worried that the National Assembly is going on with amending one bill or the other, and usually they are supposed to call a kind of stakeholders meeting, public hearing, so that the public can have input here. We're not having input.
You know, they have referred it to the committee.
Yeah.
But after the first and second reading,
it's referred to the committee. Yeah.
And completed within 2 weeks, like Nigeria's scholars and experts have observed. It's about the fastest operation in the process of affecting. Now, affecting the change.
Effectively, 6 days.
We have the PIB that has been with them for donkey years. They don't see any necessity for them to speed up action on that. We have so many action.
They've tinkered with the PIB now. The PIB is now petroleum, industry and government, you know, bill.
Okay, when is it going to come into effect? When are they going to do the first?
No, by the time they've expunged those of our communities that are oil producing communities from giving us any funds, from giving us, you know, any sense of belonging.
That is dead on arrival.
And they couldn't do that between June and now.
That is that.
It's about 11 months. No, see,
do you ever believe that that bill is going to see the light of day?
Each time they want to create, you know, when the consensus, they bring in all kinds of controversies, and then we fight the bill down by ourselves. We resist it,
yes,
and then it dies.
Yes.
And they wait for another 4 years. But when it concerns them, they do it in 3 days.
In six days,
they have gone to first and second reading, and then it goes to the committee. Before you know it,
it comes back. No, they have given the committee 2 weeks to return to report back. So
that this is going to be passed this month.
So within 1 month, they want to finish with it, but they have forgotten that it's always the issue of the House of Representatives there. And now some of them are telling them that this thing you want to do is fundamental. And fundamental is this. Okay,
Innocent from Benue State. Good morning, Innocent.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, thank you for joining us. What are your thoughts about these frauds that the National Assembly wants to surreptitiously carry out?
Yes, we worked very hard for the change government that we now have.
Mm.
And to see that we have elements at the level of the National Assembly that are supposed to be making laws for us, trying to alter this law at a time that the law is taking effect on them is really, really shameful.
It is indeed.
So we want to beg other Nigerians, those at the limelight, at the corridors of power, to support President Muhammadu Buhari to fix Nigeria for us again. We have great hopes in this country, and we are working very, very hard, but what they are doing, especially concerning the Saraki issue, we want that issue to be carefully taken care of, because we can't imagine that at a time like this, where his own state, corrupt allegations against him from his own state is being handled, they are making effort to amend the CCT or CCD, what. It's really, really shameful. We don't need people like that in our today's governance. In our today's governance, we need men of integrity who have clean track records, not men like Saraki.
You probably would have to go to Mecca and Rome, you know, yes. Well, maybe even in Jerusalem, would you even find clean people? You know, they kill the Palestinians anyhow if they just innocent.
Well, we have a clean man that we are very, very happy with now. I am a proud Nigerian today, because
yes,
I have somebody like Muhammadu Buhari, a man with high level of integrity.
Fantastic.
And all of us should key to his kind of a character.
Fantastic, Innocent. But let me just tell you one thing about what Nigerians are not doing well. In other countries,
sir,
when issues like this come up and they are anti-people, the people lock down the National Assembly. They go and sit down there from morning to morning to morning until the legislators will back down. We see it in other countries that are not even as big as us or enlightened as us. So why do we continue to say, we're always, you know, this country is a praying country, is a praying nation. I'm sure the papacy should have been in Nigeria and probably have Mecca here too.
Maybe,
you know.
He's core professional, but I think we need to talk a little bit, the politics around all of this.
Mm-hmm.
Because for me, it's no longer about, for these people, it's not about integrity.
No.
It's not about good name. It's not about the image. It's about the politics. And the politics that brought Saraki into the senior presidency is the same politics that produced Muhammadu Buhari as the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. It's the same politics that is now wanting to kill CCB, CCT.
Oh, yeah.
It's a policy that is intended to ensure that the dispensation of justice is not just made slow but killed, murdered in the process. And so we cannot take our eyes, because the politics, the political consciousness of the people is what mobilizes them to hit the street and say, we can't take this anymore. We play the politics of, if you touch, there are certain elements who are ready to die if you touch Saraki any further. You know, because... within the society, who do not even understand that this is not about
whoever it is, but rather this is about the soul and the well-being of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Mm. That, for a lot of persons, it's about, okay, look, this is the APC thing or the PDP thing. But it is way beyond all of that. And so until we see the politics in all of this and understand clearly what politics has brought us to this level and how to salvage whatever we have to ensure that the forthcoming politics is a politics that is much realistic and much relational with the people, and then we are not going anywhere yet.
Okay, let's join Harrison in Abuja. Good morning, Harrison.
Good morning, sir.
Hello, Harrison.
Yeah?
Yeah, thank you. Tell us what your thoughts are on this our topic today.
Okay, thank you very much. I've been listening and about our National Assembly. What I can say is that they are not different from every other Nigerians. You know, for me, I see most of Nigerians as corrupt people, you know, because of our system. You know, but the problem is that when we have a, you know, an issue like this, we take it as if we have never seen such a thing before. You know, in every organization in Nigeria, like ministries and even executives, they are also doing the same thing. I'm not supporting the move of changing the law. It's never a good thing. Even in this situation like this, we are already, the man is already in a court. So, and again, when we look at what is happening, especially when you people was discussing about, you know, the Fulani people killing others, it's also an executive problem. You know, what I'm trying to say is that there is corruption in Nigeria. It's endemic, you know, in every angle. We are talking about this National Assembly. What about government and this electricity? Where the government is telling us that they are going to give us a meter free. But these people increase the tariff every, will I say every month, you know? People are suffering because of corruption. It's not only National Assembly, even in the local government, you know? Local government, governors, they are dealing with us. Because
the local government, do they
come
exist
out
at all?
To demonstrate against what they are doing to us.
Harrison.
You know, people feel...
I don't think... Harrison.
Yeah.
Do you have local government existing, even in Abuja that you live? Tell me one function
of
the local government that
has been
carried
out. Only of Abuja.
Tell me one AMAC. I'm sure you live within the AMAC metropolis. Tell me one water scheme or one road that AMAC has started since you've lived in Abuja.
I can't get you right. I can't get you, please. Can you repeat it?
What I'm trying to say is that the local government administration or the councils, they only exist on paper.
Exactly.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
On what Emmanuel said, which you corroborated, already there's a whirlwind of factions or activities planned to occupy the National Assembly.
All right.
I cannot be sure. I think it's commencing tomorrow.
Okay.
But I know there is a group that...
It should be locked down. The National Assembly, let them scale defense again.
It's gaining momentum. I think it commences tomorrow. They call it occupied National Assembly. I'm not so sure. I think because I know over the weekend...
Maybe very soon, Nigerians will be occupying NPC.
Oh, over the weekend, we vote on that. We are still working on it. Christian, I think there's a need for us to go a little bit back into history. Just to let you know that this bunch of people we have in the National Assembly are still self-serving.
Mm-hmm.
Just about 3 or 3 months ago, when the social media went above with some of their nefarious activities, you know, all of a sudden a bill just
came up
to regulate
the social media.
Nigerians knocked down the National Assembly. What did they do? The bill has died.
This is
what is going to happen to CCBC.
Nigerians
do not allow them to have the rest of them. Already, we are already showing the pictures of people who are promoting the bill. The woman, Ms. Olujimi, the former deputy governor, Tufayoshe,
who is a journalist? You worked with Olujimi in now. At DBN, yes. Of course. I know Olujimi.
You are very well.
Is this how.
I told you, she said, that I will tell you something, I will tell us something after the program. I have to do with
that with Olujimi.
So, Nigerians are already working. The bill is already is an exercise in futility.
Mm.
Just like the social bill,
social media bill
is going to die a natural death. And even we are going to go before the beyond death, we need to take about our National Assembly. This is not the National Assembly Nigeria craved for when you were calling for change.
No.
We went to sleep after the victory of Buhari. We want to take back our National Assembly. People can never deliver to us change. They can never. And Nigeria can never go back to Egypt.
Because
that's Egypt. Because
that's why. You know, look at all the front pages of the newspapers.
They have started buying cars for themselves again. You can see how...
Twice the price. Limousines. These are no just... these are no... You know, Ihaza from Edo State. Let's join him. Let's go to Edo State. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, I'm also your boy here. I'm sure you're calling from Edo North.
Good morning. Yes, I'm calling from Edo State.
Oh, boy.
No, from Edo Central.
Oh, Edo Central. Okay, this is call.
It's from Edo Central.
That's how we say call now.
What the last caller just now from Abuja.
Mm.
Saying about they are talking about the local government and this. Let the facts be realistic. If the National Assembly, who have to interpret the law to us, who have to tell us about the law, and there is fraudulent in it, how do the government stand?
Mm-hmm.
And now, we fought seriously to measure that this government that just came in, that the government has to work for the benefit of every Nigerian. And the National Assembly, now they are trying to attack it, which is very bad. Please. We should be wise enough. We should allow each and everyone to be dealt with according to the rule of the law.
All right, he has a debt.
But let me just butt in, because if these processes were to, it would amaze you if it's going to be a situation where they have to do a constitutional amendment and they were going to run it through the states, houses of assembly, it would amaze you that they will get all they need to pass it, to run it through. Because the thing is, in most states, the national assemblies and the state assemblies are in the private pockets of their governors. And this stealing that we talk about is not just a matter of what happens at Abuja alone. Most of the states are totally comatose today because the states have been stolen blind.
Right?
And so if anybody is, because like I said before, we need again to revisit the politics that brought us to where we are. Because the politics of getting it by whatever means is the reason why you have persons who do not have any relationship with their, because they are sending senators who can't return to their villages. They are senators who can't go back to their constituencies. They are senators who cannot.
Do they go?
They don't go.
They don't.
And it will also amaze you, because if you go back to the House of Representatives, you may be amazed that they will also give their endorsement of what is going on at the Senate. Because all of this, every one of them have their fingers in one oil or the other. And if we are going to get, because like this is time for the people action. The people must take their destiny. I've always an advocate
into of their own hands. They shouldn't wait for any man in green to come and salvage them. We have gone beyond that.
And those ones have also been terribly corrupted.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's not going to happen, because mm-hmm. today you see privates who are driving all kinds and all manners of cars. Ask yourself, what's the income of a police officer?
When they know that their chief each month was getting 585 million naira each month, and they say, chief, this is your own. Say, what do I do with it? It's your own chair, chief. Half a billion naira.
He loses the morality to ask other people questions.
What the hell is going on in this country? Yeah. Ekene from Ghana. Good morning, Ekene.
Yeah, good morning.
Thank you for joining us, Ekene. Yeah. This is a very serious issue. Corruption everywhere. They are amending the CCTV again to hide corrupt tendencies.
For taking my call. But the issue of corruption in Nigeria is getting out of hand.
Mm-hmm.
Every area, every government system in Nigeria is about corruption. I don't know where to start. Is it from judiciary or... I don't know. Everywhere is corrupt together. Ordinary people have to wake up and challenge those in power in Nigeria for them to know that without us, they can't be there. But if they went there, they are still there. They are looking at as their own personal property.
So, well, we have to wait another... We have to wait until 2019 now and change these people.
I think we're making a great mistake
waiting for 2019. Okay.
With what Nigerians were able to accomplish over the social media, anti-social media bill, that's how we label it. If Nigerians could get those people, these National Assembly members, to consign that bill into the dustbin of history, we can as well get our whatever we want to do.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, that we have been complacent. We don't believe, because an average Nigerian is a government on its own. You provide your water, you provide your electricity, you even organize yourself to fix your road. So people didn't even have any feelings about the government. But we have said no, that we should put an end to that. Why are we queuing in the sun and rain to elect these people? Why are they collecting humongous or stupendous money at the end of the month as their allowances? It is true. I remember that some years back, I think it was when Dimitri Bakoli was then the Speaker of the House, the Revenue Allocation and Fiscal Commission released a document that in the whole of that year, the total package salary of government officials was 33 billion naira.
Yeah.
Just salary. But the allowances was 1.6 trillion naira.
Yeah.
And this thing has increased from then. It is more than that now. So if you are paying them allowance of 1.6 trillion naira, I think Nigeria should demand for them good governance. If you cannot, that's why we don't have to wait until 2019. Like, so we have recovered. Do you know that there is an indication of Nigeria? We have a process of recall.
Oh, yeah.
If you are not satisfied with what your guy that is representing you, you can start the process.
You're right to
IMF. If you are not going to achieve it, let us commence it. So that they will know that Nigerians are conscious of the fact that we can recall them. We can impeach a governor. You can impeach a president. Those who drafted the constitution says you can also impeach yourself, remember that representing you, by process, starting the process of recall.
Mm-hmm.
It is very tedious process. Very, very tedious. But let us start it once in, so that they will know that we are conscious of this thing, and then they will begin to behave. We cannot fold the arms again.
I think before we go into that, we need to understand what informs the impunity of those who are in the Senate and in the House of
Commons. What does inform it?
It's not just that we've been lackadaisical. It's the fact that the processes of their emergence, it is not reliant on the people. That's fundamental, because the thing is, most people who voted for whoever it is that was going to the Senate or the House of Reps was looking at what political platform they were imagining.
Of this.
So it's either this
or that. This party or
this party. And the processes of the electoral processes was also corrupt, because I stood at the polling station and I saw the fiscal distribution of money.
No, that one is always there.
On election day. And then if the processes are compromised, and characters emerge through those compromised processes, you don't expect them to be above board.
They won't serve you.
They can't serve you, because
they're not for you.
In the next 4 years, they are going to go back into office, whether you agree or do not agree. And if you're talking about the process of recall, I can assure you, if you start the process, you are going to have people wait for you. Members of your community who are going to beat you up for raising your
voice. They've not killed you. Did you say beat?
That's why I said let us even commence it, because this thing is there. But
you know why the social media bill was killed actually, because for some of them also there, they also use the social media
to do
their mischief. So they also knew the need for them to have the social media functional and run, and so it was convenient for them to say, okay.
No, what they didn't want to kill it. They wanted to regulate
it. They wanted to muscle it.
Ahead. So that's exactly what they wanted to do. But because Nigerians rose up and said, no, we aren't taking this from you. That's why not that they wanted to kill the social media, because many of them rode into office on the platform.
Yes, they did. They did. But. Okay, let's take this caller. Oh, this is my namesake. Hello, Christian.
Yeah, my man. I greet you.
All right. Good morning and welcome.
I am calling from Abuja.
Very well. We can see that.
Yeah. I think we have been talking about corruption.
Yeah.
And we still go to nowhere. Because we have not faced this corruption as it's so supposed to be, by tackling it from the foundation.
Okay.
So if we can continue this for 20 years and we remain the same in Nigeria, until honesty truth become our watchword, nothing will come out of Nigeria. We pretend to be good, but we are not. We pretend to be one Nigeria, but we are not. We pretend in everything. We say we are fighting corruption, but you see us doing the wrong thing all the time. And if we must be honest with ourselves, we must do away with our system, our approach to things, tribalism, division and dichotomy. And we must pick the right people at the helm of affairs. No matter where you come from, no matter the place you are or from who position you're coming from, we must be honest first. I like what you've been doing.
Thank you.
Because most of the time I watch you. And when I see you, I become proud of some Nigerians too. Because your goal is to ask questions. You're not afraid. That is what you should keep on. And if we want to be truthful to ourselves, we must tell Nigeria the truth. We have many of Saraki kind in Nigeria. They are free roaming about the streets. And you want to heal it. Can you wash a stream from the down of the river? You must wash it from the source. Mm. And if you can't do that, the stream will remain polluted.
Okay, thank you very much. That's my namesake from Abuja, Christian, calling in. Still things that we have a long way to go in really redressing the problem, because it's like we are bordered, surrounded, you know, washed in, soaked in corruption, in all ramifications and the rest. But, you know, it's what those, even at the rung of the ladder, see upstairs that has affected and influenced them too.
Yeah, but, you know, you grew up here. I grew up here. There were days when you couldn't drive a car that your wages could not buy.
Mm.
There were days when,
because it would be queried. It would be queried. Where did you get the money
there
from?
There were days you couldn't buy a shirt you couldn't afford and wear it at home because your parents were going to ask you, how did you get it? But we have left our values and we have concentrated so much on this, material. How much money do you have at your disposal?
Mm.
How do people get 50,000 in Nigeria? It's about how much money you have. Because they say, okay, he has made so much contribution to the community. What manners of contribution? And nobody is asking, how did he come about the money? And so when we lost focus, when we took our eyes off the fundamentals and we began to concentrate on how much money and how much, you know, of material things somebody could exhibit and began to celebrate it. And then we just... It's natural that this is what we're going to get. And so a senator, I will tell you for a fact, Olusegun Obasanjo made an analogy that just a few months before the elections, that his birthday was celebrated on the pages of the newspaper. And that, that immediately after the elections, he had his birthday and he was alone with his family. Not even anybody visited him. And so when you have that kind of scenario, you ask yourself, because this all began, I challenge anybody who cares to listen. A few years ago, when before the advent of the 1976, 1975, 1976 coup, people tried as much as possible to even conceive whatever they had. And people waited for their pension and their gratuity. It was a pride that you had done 30, 35 years in service and you were living on your pension.
Mm-hmm.
And then we walked away. Under whatever excuse or guise, we wiped away a generation of credible civil servants. And then we took away the feeling and the reassurance of job security. Mm-hmm. So maybe you take this.
Okay, let's quickly join Lukman from Kwara. Good morning, Lukman.
Good morning, sir.
Yes, this concerns your brethren, eh?
Sir?
I said the issue we're discussing concerns your brethren, the strong man of Kwara politics.
Yes, it's about the president.
Huh?
It's about the president.
Okay.
About the Senate president.
Absolutely, that's what we're talking here. Go on.
Sir, I don't want Mr. President to sign that bill that the Senate passed through.
Good.
concerning the CCTs we remove from the government to the Senate. Are you with me?
Very well, we are with you.
Sir, I'm not out on that, sir.
Okay, you don't like it.
And I have a question to ask about.
Go on.
Are you hearing me?
Go on.
Sir, I just want to assure that people are saying that Mr. President has spent $20 billion on each troop that are driving out. I just want to confirm, is it true?
It's not true.
Huh?
It's not true. It's not true. At least I can speak.
Please,
can...
you tell me the how much they are paying on the each troop that...
On each trip? That the president spends on each trip. Okay, but
let you know the amount.
Let me just know. I don't know the figure, but I'll tell you that it's not true. He cannot spend $20 billion.
That
is
what people say, because people are there that Mr. President also corrupt like others.
Okay, thank you very much, Lukman.
I'm sure you must have been watching The People, and the producer of The People is back. When The People talk to The People, you know.
My friend, we call it Baba Shop discussion. Now, on a more
serious note, yeah.
You see, the issue we have on our hand is a very serious one.
It is indeed.
And I think the time has come for Nigerians to know that we need to come together to save this, our democracy.
Yeah.
We labor so much, apparently before the military left office.
Mm.
And let me just mention something. I have a friend, Barrister Teo. He said when he was growing up, and his elder brother left secondary school and left the village to go to Enugu, because the guy from Imo State to start work. Sometimes later, the guy came to the village with a bicycle.
Hmm.
He said, they all, you know, small children, mm-hmm. and they welcomed him, they were happy, oh, he had brought a bicycle. He said, but they declared that the father was not happy, that the father called him into the room. You just left village for the town.
Yeah.
How did you get money to buy a bicycle? That it happened in Nigeria, not outside this country. But like Femi said, these days you run into some of your guys cruising one car you cannot explain, and what you hear is everybody hails. Where did we lose it? I think that is the point Nigerians should look at. How did we lose it? Maybe when we go back there, we'll have answers to the problems we have in this country. That's my question.
Thank you very much. Let's Femi, let's have your closing remark on this.
Well, my closing remark is that we only have this country and no other. And we can't afford to lay back and do nothing. We must stand up and fight for that which belongs to us. This country belongs to us. We cannot fold our arms and watch anybody ruin it, including the members of the National Assembly.
There's probably a lot of political enlightenment that gentlemen were not doing.
Yeah.
Yes, I have a clean journalist. I am not happy, especially with all of back of what we are doing. Because you see a lot of ignorance in the air,
mm-hmm.
and I think the problem came from us.
Yeah.
At times when you, these days I hardly comment on headlines, because you read headline, you read
the body of the story. The body of the story is quite different.
And even at times when you read the body of the story, it looks as if somebody just sat under the tree with a bottle of beer and concocted. I'm very happy for that word you use. And concocted story. I am a journalist. I organize press conference.
But we see them now.
I organize press conferences.
But we see them. Even in National Assembly in the good old days. And it will make the front pages. Okadigbo, before he died, when Okadigbo stepped down, the man stepped down from his high table and said, I cannot be a judge advocate in my own case. And the media, some of the papers, they went on to say Okadigbo was impeached. In fact, one put as headline that Okadigbo vomited blood.
Christian, I organize press conferences. I invite journalists. The following day when I pick up newspapers to read what those journalists have written, I shake my head.
It's not
what we did yesterday.
It's not what happened at this
press. It is as bad as that. So when you see a lot of Nigerians expressing their sentiment, it is based on the ignorance spread by Nigerian journalists.
Maybe Dupont, that's why they call some of them press boys. All right. It's been a wonderful Monday morning, you know. The one that we can laugh in the midst of very serious issue. But I'm not a press boy. I'm a journalist, so you call me a media man. The press boys are the lithographers and the rest that you find in Shomolu and all of you. You get the point. Nobody ever addresses me as a press boy. Thank you very much, Femi Enofe, as usual. Prolific public affairs analyst. And my colleague brother there, Dikbo Layoku. Thanks for finding time to be with us. And our very esteemed viewers and callers, keep the calls, you know, coming in again, and tomorrow is going to be another day. Well, I can't just quickly release the topic for tomorrow here, but don't worry, we'll come your way again. My name is Christian Ogodo. On behalf of the entire production crew, thanks for watching, and bye-bye.
Is it what Chrissy? Or talk Chrissy? Or what type of Chrissy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, genuine looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Kill me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our ministry to disrepute. I said to help
on Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.